6 on Unsolved Mysteries. A violent gang member terrorizes the quiet streets of Milwaukee, leaving 3 innocent people dead. Marie Hilley seemed to be the perfect suburban wife and mother, until she poisoned her entire family. For over 100 years, mysterious lights have appeared and disappeared near Marfa, Texas. What could they be? And a pregnant woman vanishes without a trace. Police think her husband knows more than he's letting on. There is just nothing like a good mystery, and they're even better when they're true. I'm Dennis Farina. Join me, won't you? The south side of Milwaukee was home to a gang of drug dealers known as the Lopez family. They owned 7 houses in a 2-block radius and used this location as headquarters for their drug empire. When a rival gang called the Latin Kings tried to move in on their territory, the Lopez family took action. Anyone who got in their way had to face this man, Arthur, the Lopez family's hitman. Carlos Hernandez got in their way. He was once a member of the Latin Kings, but according to his family, Carlos had recently left the gang and turned his life around.
He just seen drive-bys, and he started to see how very rarely do they hit their intended target. They'll hit innocent bystanders, kids playing on their bikes in front of their houses. He felt best that he'd get out the gang and turn it around and really try to help the neighborhood come back to what it was once before.
Carlos organized a youth basketball league and worked for a city organization that helps kids stay out of gangs.
A major part of his job was to try and mediate problems between the gangs in that particular area.
So what do you think, Pop?
The Lopez family had come to Mr. Hernandez with a problem with the Latin Kings over territory.
Police believe that Carlos tried to end the gang turf war, but was unsuccessful. The Lopez family hitman, Arthur, was told to, quote, take care of Carlos.
There was a predetermined code that they were going to broadcast on the radio when Mr. Hernandez was spotted. The code was, it's a beautiful day in the neighborhood, and that code was put out when Mr. Hernandez left from his business to his vehicle.
Lopez put on a mask, hopped on a bike, and pedaled toward his unsuspecting target. Carlos was hit by multiple bullets and died instantly.
It was a nightmare. We miss him. The hardest part is at family gatherings, seeing my sister and my mother cry.
Arthur Lopez was the prime suspect in the killing of Carlos Hernandez, but police had little evidence against him. And then he made what seemed like a little mistake. It would be the beginning of the end for the Lopez family. He got himself arrested for driving without a license.
Why you arresting my son?
Arthur's father, Arturo, was second in command of the Lopez gang. Arturo showed up at the station, and he wasn't too happy.
Arturo Lopez Sr. demanded the release of his son.
I'd get my strap and smoke all you're under.
And threatened to kill all the police officers who were involved in Arthur Lopez Jr.'s arrest.
Arturo was arrested and convicted of threatening a police officer. Arturo was sentenced to 18 months in jail.
Arthur could not be held on the traffic charge and was released. This gave the police the chance that they were looking for.
While Arturo Lopez Sr. was in prison, he made daily phone calls to his son and other members of the Lopez family, directing the continued narcotics distribution activities of the Lopez gang.
He's gonna give you a paquete. I want you to drop it off at Chino's pad.
All of these phone calls that were made by Arturo Lopez Sr. were recorded by the prison phone system.
As authorities continued to build their case against the Lopez gang, there was another outburst of violence. According to witnesses, Arthur again played a key role. Maximiliano Castillo, a known member of the Latin Kings, and his girlfriend, Vanessa Rivas, were returning home after a quick trip to the grocery store. Police believe that the driver was Arthur and that his passenger was another Lopez gang member named Luis Acevedo.
¿Qué pasó, Holmes?
¿Qué pasó, bro? I got a message from a friend. Dead man, punk!
Vanessa, a completely innocent bystander, had just celebrated her 15th birthday.
Vanessa Rivas was hit once in the side. She basically bled to death. Mr. Castillo was struck a number of times, at least three times, by the bullets fired by Mr. Acevedo, and he also died from his injuries.
Authorities used Arturo's taped phone calls from jail and eyewitness testimony to obtain arrest warrants for Arthur and the rest of the Lopez family. A task force moved in to put the Lopez gang out of business for good. In the raid, police seized large stashes of guns, drugs, and cash. Eight people were arrested, finally ending the family's crime wave. Only one Lopez family member managed to escape the citywide dragnet. Arthur.
He's got to pay. He's done so much hurt to many people, families, and he's a coward. He's hiding. We need to get him.
Arthur Lopez is 5'9", weighs 170 pounds, and is known by the name Red Rider. Update. Arthur Lopez has finally been captured and convicted and sent to prison. Next, they only come out at night. Eerie balls of light that have mystified a small Texas town for over a century. The place, Central Texas, just outside the town of Marfa, the year 1883. One evening during a roundup, a rancher named Robert Ellison notices a strange glow off in the distance. A ghostly light shimmers in the darkness. It appears to be a few miles away, and it hovers just a few feet above the ground.
They thought there were probably a campfire, Indians or other travelers, but they just kept seeing them. The next night they were there, and the next night, and the next week and year, and I'm sure they began to wonder what on earth were those lights.
In 1916, Hallie Stillwell is 18 years old when she witnesses the same thing.
We had decided to come to Marfa to attend to a little business. And all of a sudden, we saw lights over on the Shenandoah Mountains. It couldn't be any kind of car lights. And we first thought probably it was a campfire of Indians or Mexicans or ranchers, but it didn't act like a campfire at all. So we said, well, it couldn't be anything but a ghost. And from then on, we mentioned them as ghost lights.
In 1943, the mysterious lights are seen from Marfa's Army Air Base.
He won't be back When we saw the Marfa lights the first time, there was no vehicular traffic at night. Fuel was rationed. Lights were a phenomena in themselves in those days because there were no lights. When the moon is out, it's beautiful. When the moon is not out, it's so dark, it's awesome. We saw something that was totally foreign to anything in and around the airbase. When we inquired in the village of Marfa about these strange things, I thought, yeah, sure, we've got little lights. So what else?
Over the years, the reasons for the mysterious lights have ranged from ball lightning to wandering spirits to jackrabbits with glowworms attached to their tails. Only one thing is for certain. Marfa's ghost lights are real. No one in Marfa is really afraid of the mysterious lights. In fact, the town has set up a special area where you can actually view them.
When I was a child, of course, you have a lot of childlike curiosity, and my first thing was, I want to find out what those are. I mean, this is my Loch Ness monster. I'm going to catch it and find out what it is. And so I just, from that moment on, decided I was going to try to solve the mystery.
Looks like we need to head southeast toward the Shenatis.
A few years ago, my brother and I got the idea that the reason no one had ever gotten close to the lights was because they were using motor vehicles, like airplanes or jeeps or cars. So we thought if we took out on foot across the desert, we could sneak up on them. So we got our gear together and a camera and just took out walking across the desert and tried for about 4 hours to walk up close to them. And we never could get real close to them. It was almost like a mirage. It just kept moving a little further and further away from you.
We asked three scientists from a local observatory and university to conduct a formal investigation. Our team of scientists noted that a radio tower was one possible source of the lights. So was traffic on a mountain highway. They installed marker lights that helped determine where the highway was visible in order to rule out headlights. If the scientists saw lights that weren't from cars or from the tower, they just might be the legendary ghost lights. The investigators use special night vision equipment. In this shot, the camera captures two headlights moving slowly from left to right, past the radio beacon light. Then, an unknown light appears.
Doctor, look up there on the hill. To the right of marker three.
I see it. It's off to the right.
The camera pans past the radio beacon.
Unit three, can you verify if you have any traffic lights off to the west or northwest?
I do not see any lights.
It continues past the right marker light. In the middle of an empty plain, a ghostly glow can be seen. A video camera also records the light.
We know the lights are there. We know it is something of natural origin. It is not man-made. Now the next question is, how do you explain them?
There is something in addition to car lights. People are seeing real activity in the atmosphere.
One scientist thought the lights might be refracted starlight. Another, glowing gases produced by small earthquakes. But they aren't sure. All they can say for certain is that the lights are a natural phenomenon that science has yet to explain.
It's a phenomenon that's not explained, and all I know is they're there.
Let's don't find out what they are. Let's just leave them a mystery.
I'm not gonna try to solve it. I'm gonna be content with ghost and let the ghost take care of them.
Next, we take you inside the mind of a diabolical serial killer who poisoned her entire family. It may not surprise you to know that most killers and mass murderers are men. There are, however, a few diabolical women who cleverly conceal their true nature behind a veil of tenderness and warmth. Anniston, Alabama. Frank and Marie Hilley were married in 1950, and they built a life that was the envy of their friends and neighbors. By 1971, the Hilleys had two children, 18-year-old Mike and 11-year-old Carol. By all appearances, Marie was the perfect wife and mother. But in this case, appearances deceive.
I first started getting sick when I was 18. A lot of stomach problems. And I started having those problems about 2 or 3 months after an insurance policy was taken out on me for $25,000.
Mike's doctors were unable to diagnose or cure his ongoing stomach ailments. But once Mike left for college, the symptoms disappeared. It wasn't long before his father also developed a mysterious stomach problem. Once again, doctors were unable to find a cause or a cure. Around the same time he got sick, Frank was considering getting a divorce.
My father called me one day and had something he wanted to talk to me about. He had come home from work early one day and had found my mother in bed with one of her employers. I think my father was going to divorce her.
Whatever you do.
I think that was one circumstance that she just wouldn't allow to happen.
I love you too, Pop.
She placed a high value on prominence and reputation. And to go through a divorce would have destroyed that.
Within 2 weeks of confiding in Mike, Frank Hilley's mysterious disorder suddenly worsened. Frank was admitted to the local hospital. Marie was constantly by his side, feeding and caring for him, and tending to his every need.
You've got to eat, Frank.
But after 10 days in the hospital, Frank Hilley died. The official cause of death was hepatitis. Nobody suspected the truth. Marie was not your typical grieving widow. She used Frank's life insurance money to refurbish her house and buy a new car and expensive clothes and jewelry. Even when the money ran out, she kept right on spending.
We became aware that Marie was having financial problems. There were some deals with automobiles that she had made that fell through and weren't paid for. Just a lot of little things that began to add up.
My mother's finances were in terrible shape. She owed more than she had. She couldn't pay her bills. I began to receive phone calls from creditors wanting the money.
4 years after her father's death, 18-year-old Carol Hilley suddenly became sick. Nobody knew that Marie had insured Carol's life for $25,000.
During the time that everyone was getting sick, I think someone, a relative in the family, suspected that something was going on, and like me later on, something is, but what?
Carol was in and out of the hospital for 6 months and finally became paralyzed from the waist down. Still, doctors could not diagnose her illness. In desperation, Carol agreed to let Marie inject her with what she said was a new medicine that she got from a friend who was a nurse.
Okay, sweetie, this is gonna sting a little bit.
I remember my aunt telling me that my mother had Carol in seclusion, would not let anybody see her, would not let anyone talk to her, and if something didn't happen, Carol was going to die.
How can I help you, detective?
While at the hospital with Carol, Marie was arrested for passing bad checks. This probably saved Carol's life.
One of Carol's friends at that time told me that she had visited Carol that day, and Carol had mentioned something about injections that my mother had given her.
Yeah, just look straight ahead for me, would you?
Mm-hmm.
That's good.
Mike demanded the hospital staff re-examined Carol. Doctors discovered white lines across Carol's fingernails, the unmistakable sign of arsenic poisoning.
The world as I knew it at that point just fell apart. Everything that I had been taught to rely on was totally in question. Everything that my mother had taught me, right from wrong, I had to go back and re-examine.
Carol Hilley eventually recovered, but Mike was forced to consider that his mother had probably murdered his father. At Mike's request, and surprisingly with Marie's permission, Frank Hilley's body was exhumed for a second autopsy. The revised cause of death? Arsenic poisoning. But Marie quietly slipped out of town 3 weeks before the results were released. An arrest warrant was issued charging Marie with the murder of her husband. But by then, Marie Hilley was long gone. Seven 700 miles away in Fort Lauderdale, Marie resurfaced with a new identity. Robbie Hannon.
John, could I have a light?
Oh, sure.
John Holman, who was from New Hampshire, was pleased to meet Robbie Hannon.
Robbie, right?
Robbie, a.k.a. Marie Hilley, told John that she was a widow and that she would soon inherit a large estate. She also told him that she had brain cancer. The Robbie Hannon character was skillfully and deliberately created. She was attractive, she was available, she was going to be rich, and she might die sometime in the future. The possibilities were endless. 6 months later, Robbie and John were married. She found work as a secretary and was welcomed into John's social circles. About a year later, Robbie informed John that her brain cancer had worsened. She flew alone to Texas for special medical tests. John Holman never saw Robbie again.
He got a call sometime later from Robbie Hannon's twin sister, Terry Martin. Robbie had died and the body had been donated to science and all the arrangements had been made, so there was nothing for him to do.
Several weeks later, Robbie's sister, Terry Martin, came to New Hampshire with an emotional farewell letter Robbie had written to John just before she died.
Terry?
Terry Martin was really Marie Hilley. She had lost 20 pounds, dyed her hair blonde, and boldly returned to New Hampshire as her own twin sister.
You must be John. I'm Terry Martin, Robbie's sister.
John Holman accepted Terry at face value. She moved in with him, and they lived together for 2 months. However, some of John's neighbors became suspicious. When they tried to verify Terry's story, nothing checked out. Ultimately, Marie Hilley was trapped by a strange coincidence. Her description just happened to match that of a totally different female fugitive. Marie Hilley, a.k.a. Robbie Hannon, a.k.a. Terry Martin, was taken into custody for questioning.
After she was picked up, they had no idea that she was actually Marie Hilley and that she was wanted in Alabama for murder and attempted to poison her daughter. Once she was picked up, then they've learned who, in fact, she really was.
Marie was convicted of murder and attempted murder and sentenced to life plus 20 years. 5 years into her term, she escaped while on a 3-day pass and died a week later from exposure.
My mother had a lot of charisma and charm, and she knew how to use that. She had the ability to make you believe what she was saying, even if you knew that it was an outright lie. And she had the ability to make you believe that you were the most important thing in her life. And that could have been the furthest thing from the truth.
What drove a wife and a mother to poison her own family members? Like Marie Hilley, the answer will forever remain a mystery. Next, a woman who is 8 months pregnant receives a mysterious phone call, and then she disappears. Chatsworth, California. After a passionate 2-year courtship, Alfredo Newball and Cecilia Amaya got married. Cecilia's son from a previous marriage, Rene Perez, was their ring bearer at their wedding. The couple started their new life together, and almost immediately, Cecilia became pregnant. One September afternoon, with her due date only 2 weeks away, Cecilia sat down to write thank you notes for the gifts from her baby shower. That day, as Alfredo left for work, he says that he hesitated at the door for a moment.
Being pregnant, she looked so beautiful, and I went back and kissed her again. I left her sitting inside the apartment writing the thank you notes, and that was the last time that I saw my wife.
Alfredo worked as a nurse's assistant in a hospital and retirement home. 2.5 hours into his shift, he phoned Cecilia.
I just had some kind of very weird feeling that something was wrong. She never answered the phone, and I don't know, for some reason, I thought that she could be visiting with some friends or being at my mom's.
Alfredo called several times throughout the evening. Concerned, he left work early. As he approached the apartment, he noticed that Cecilia's car was parked on the street instead of in the building's secured lot.
Cecilia!
Inside, there were no signs of a struggle or a break-in, but there were also no signs of Cecilia and Renee either. In the Jeep, Alfredo says that he found a store-bought generic goodbye card. It was signed simply, Cecilia. Cecilia's wedding and engagement rings had been left on the passenger seat. To Alfredo, the message was clear. His wife had left him.
The relationship was always good. We never had any problems, fights. Why would she do something like this? But to leave me a note like that and to leave the wedding rings, it was very confusing to me.
Alfredo phoned the one person that he thought might know where she was, her closest friend at work, Kevin Annabelle. It was this phone call that first cast suspicion on Alfredo.
Hello?
Kevin, this is Al.
Yeah, Al. What time is it?
I don't know, it's about midnight. Is Cece there?
What?
She's gotta be there, put her on. I came home, she's not here.
He was unusually calm. Like, if it were me, I would have been screaming at the person I thought where my wife was. But I was more nervous and excited than he was.
I felt like she needed to be away for a few days or something. I don't know. It was very strange, but I believe that she was coming back soon.
It appeared that nothing was taken by Cecilia or her son, Renee. All his toys were left there, clothing was left there, not so much as a toothbrush.
Hello, is this Alfredo Newball?
The day after Cecilia disappeared, the police called Alfredo.
Tell me, Mr. Newball, when was the last time you saw her wife, Cecilia?
Yesterday afternoon. I was getting ready to go to work, then I gave her a kiss and that was it.
Mr. Newball didn't appear to be that concerned. And here he has a 8.5-month pregnant wife, a 6-year-old stepson. Mr. Newball just didn't appear to be the grieving husband, soon to be father.
3 days later, suspicion increased when Alfredo received a letter postmarked in nearby Van Nuys, California. Inside the envelope was a card identical to the one Alfredo had found in Cecilia's car. There was also a typewritten note.
Alfredo, I have gone to Honduras with a man I met 9 months ago by the name of Arturo. He's a doctor. I don't know if this baby is yours or his. I love you with all my heart, but you will not amount to anything. And I want only the best for my baby. Alfredo, you can't give us that. Adios, Cecilia and René.
My first impression after opening the letter was that she had left. But then it's after reviewing the letter several times, some parts, it don't sound like Cecilia. It doesn't strike me as a Cecilia at all.
Kevin Annabelle also found the letter out of character.
I would say she was almost obsessed with Al. And when you're that in love with a person, you don't just meet a doctor and say, well, I think I'm going to Honduras. Let me just write my husband a note. That doesn't happen.
I took a look at the letter, spoke to friends and family of Cecilia later on, and I'm convinced that that letter is not from Cecilia. Whoever typed this letter knew more about Alfredo's side of the family rather than knowing very much about Cecilia's side of the family. My best guess is that Cecilia's disappearance is not by her will. I believe there's a third party involved in this.
6 months before she disappeared, Cecilia received an odd phone call.
What?
She had gotten a call that a woman had a videotape of Al kissing another woman at a baby shower, and that the woman wanted Cecilia to see the tape, and Cecilia had agreed to see the tape.
Okay, yes, I know what is that. 8 o'clock?
The woman said that she would phone again to arrange a meeting, but that call never came, and the matter was apparently forgotten. Then, just a few weeks before Cecilia disappeared, a second mysterious call. This one from a woman who claimed to work with Alfredo.
A woman had called and said that she was giving Al, they were gonna give Al a baby shower at work, and that she had some baby furniture and she wanted Cecilia to pick out a piece of that furniture, but to keep it a secret because the shower was gonna be a surprise.
On the 20th? Yeah, that's fine.
Later, police learned that the call had not been made by Alfredo's co-worker and that a baby shower had not been planned. But by then, it was too late.
She disappeared on Tuesday, the day she was supposed to get together with this lady to pick out a piece of furniture for the baby shower.
It appears that someone is trying to lure her away from safety, away from her family, away from her friends, trying to get her alone.
I just want to know what happened to them. And that's what I really need the public's help finding something about this case.
It's my opinion that Mr. Newball is not telling me everything that he knows. As far as Cecilia's disappearance, he may not have been there when she disappeared, but it's my opinion that he knows something now.
Cecilia Newball is 5 feet tall and weighs just over 90 pounds. She was born in El Salvador and speaks with a pronounced Latin accent. Her son, René Perez, would now be in his 20s and may look like this age-progressed photograph. If you have any information about Cecilia or René, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, the search for three Good Samaritans who befriended a runaway girl on a bus trip to Texas. Washington, D.C. 15-year-old Michelle Donahoe has decided to run away from home. She tries to make herself appear older and more confident, but on the inside, she is completely terrified. Nonetheless, Michelle has the presence of mind to use a fake name when speaking to the ticket agent. 4 months earlier, Michelle Donahoe's family had moved from San Antonio, Texas, to Fairfax, Virginia. Michelle was very upset, and she never forgave her parents for taking her away from her friends and her school. And now Michelle was going back to Texas, the place that she called home.
I was scared at that point just because I'd never really been anywhere by myself before, and this was an environment that I wasn't real familiar with. I had never been among all these strangers before, and, you know, people would look at you, and first I thought, well, maybe they're just wondering why I'm young and I'm on this bus by myself, but then you kind of get the idea that people are, especially men, you know, are mainly looking to see that you're alone and, you know, try and bother you. That's when it really started to be scary because I couldn't protect myself and I didn't, you know, nobody knew where I was. So if something would have happened to me, nobody would know it.
At a stop in North Carolina, three men boarded the bus together.
I remember thinking, you know, as far as men goes, I was staying away from as many as I could. And especially one of them looked pretty scary. He had really a lot of scars on his body. So I was sitting next to him and I thought, that's great. But they came and they sat around and they were talking among themselves.
Wait till in a couple, man.
Think you sleep now, man.
Tired.
You ain't done it.
While the three men slept on and off, Michelle's nerves kept her wide awake. But as the trip progressed, Michelle observed that the men were not as scary as they first appeared.
He does not snore. Thank you very much.
Eventually, Michelle relaxed around them.
Why did they call you Tiny Feet?
Are you kidding?
The one really big guy, his name was Tiny Feet because his feet were huge.
Thank you. No, miss, we're truckers. And Tiny Feet is his handle. See, me, I'm a deacon in my church back in North Carolina. They call me Doc because I got a Bible verse for everything that ails you.
That's right. My name is Sunshine.
Yeah.
Named after my favorite song, actually.
It just made me feel like, you know, he was more of a family man and I didn't really have to worry. And the rest of them talked about their families and Doc kept talking about his church, you know, and the people in his church and what they were like. And I just, I felt at ease with them then. I didn't feel like I had anything to fear from them.
By the time the bus pulled into Atlanta, Doc, Sunshine, and Tiny Feet had practically adopted Michelle. When they sat down for breakfast, Tiny Feet noticed another girl who appeared to be in trouble.
I want you to come take a ride.
Leave me alone.
No, wait, hey, excuse me. Look, is he bothering you?
Yes.
Listen, we're about to sit down and have breakfast. Why don't you come join us for breakfast, okay? And we'll just talk, okay? All right.
She came over and we bought her breakfast and she told us her story. And she was a runaway also. And, you know, I guess at that point I kind of sat back and watched and saw how they helped people. And it wasn't just me, it was other people. They were just like good Samaritans on the road kind of thing.
You guys?
Michelle felt so comfortable with her new friends, she finally confessed her real name, her age, and that she was a runaway.
They're probably very worried about you. That's right, if it was my kids, I'd be going crazy.
Yeah, it could get real dangerous out here.
You know, they didn't react badly to it. They were actually really comforting about it, and they knew that I was scared. And that's the first time I was actually able to tell somebody, I'm really scared doing this.
The next morning, the bus arrived in Mississippi, where the men were supposed to pick up their trucks.
Listen, I want you to take my card. It has both my home number and my church number on it.
Okay.
And please, if you ever need a place to stay, call me.
All right.
My wife and I have plenty of rooms.
Sunshine could not leave without making a request.
Listen, Michelle, all I ask is that you call your mom and let her know you're okay.
I will.
All right, will you do that for me? You promise. Good luck.
I was sad to see them go. So I think they were worried about me, and I started to worry about me too when they got off the bus because all of a sudden I felt scared and alone. You know, I didn't have people to protect me anymore.
Later that afternoon, Michelle kept her promise to Sunshine, at least in a way.
I got up there and I lost my nerve, and I didn't have the nerve to talk to my parents because by this time I realized that they'd probably be really upset. So I called a friend of mine and I asked her to call my parents and let them know I was okay. I got back on the bus and there was a girl there, probably my same age, she was young. And she was sitting by herself with a paper bag full of things.
Hi. You want some donuts? I have some extras.
Yeah. Thanks.
I guess I switched somewhere during that trip to instead of just thinking about myself and how, terrible my life was, to thinking about other people. You know, listening to stories of people on the road and other runaways. I wasn't a typical runaway. And when I'd listen to their stories and then think about my reasons, or they'd ask me, why did you run away? I didn't want to say because it sounded so stupid by then, my parents gave me a curfew and, made me catch the bus in the morning. It just sounded so ridiculous compared to their really tragic stories.
Michelle finally made it to a friend's home in Texas, where her father picked her up. She was relieved to go back home. Over the years, Michelle never forgot the three men who made such a difference in her life. Her one wish was to say thank you. Update. A man named Jesse Garrett was watching Unsolved Mysteries when he not only recognized Michelle, but also recognized himself as the man called Doc. Jesse phoned Sunshine, whose real name is Bill Polite, and they contacted us. The men, both preachers, had lost touch with Rufus Tiny Feet Wheeler. Jesse and Bill spoke with Michelle, and they were thrilled to find out that they had such a positive effect on her life. They hope to meet with her sometime in the near future.